I'm assigning you a personal essay, not about physics, but about you and what kind of person you want to be.
Now you on your own, Ma. Oh, slow down a little. That's better. Earth. See what you got now? Make the mistakes part of it.
This clip of Miles trying to write an essay is like me trying to explain my thoughts on the Spider-Verse. Just like comic books surpassed the expectations of nerds, this movie surpassed my expectations wonderfully.
Which has taught me a very great lesson. The world is so crazy that if you present things the way they really are, it comes across as broad satire. And
with that in mind, let's start with the psychology of Into the Spider-Verse, and let's talk about a couple life lessons that we learned from Miles Morales. Expectations are a funny thing. One of the cool things about this movie is it subverts your expectations. For instance, this Miles Morales isn't the stereotypical Spider-Man that we see.
The cool thing about Miles is his heritage is both African-American, it's also Puerto Rican on his mom's side.
In harmony with that, this movie isn't the typical type of kids movie that you see. Just because it's animated doesn't mean it's for kids. And this dog keeps subverting my expectations because I think he's quiet and then he starts barking again. And then the expectations continue to be subverted. Being a young person and an adolescent, a lot of times you're expected to have your stuff together, especially when you go to school and go to different programs and whatnot. Case in point, Miles in school. Just like Miles has a blank slate on his desk, this character and adolescents in general, they're a blank space. And that's a good thing, meaning that even though we were pushed in certain directions, really when it comes to us and what we want to do, there's endless possibilities. When you have unbalanced expectations, you can feel a sense of loss and like you're losing control. There's a quote about expectations that I really, really like. When you learn to let go of your unrealistic expectations, an open road unfolds right in front of you. One full of new possibilities, ready and waiting for you to create your own path. Who Miles is and what he's about is a figurative blank space for us, the audience. So think about that quote as we go throughout the movie, because Miles is literally on a new path that's full of possibilities. And one of the things that motivates Miles and that moves him is actually the music in the film is something that I absolutely love. In fact, I'm a music nerd and I'm a geek, and I love how this movie doesn't just use music as something to make you feel good or something just to throw in the movie. The music and the lyrics are specifically written to move Miles along throughout his story. Obviously, you have Sunflower, which at first is something to help relax Miles Morales, but the more you listen to the song, the more you realize this song, Sunflower, actually talks about the complications of being a superhero or being Spider-Man. Another cool thing about this movie is that it's actually diegetic. Now, diegetic or diegetic sound is any sound that the character or characters on screen can hear. Why is this important and why are the music and the lyrics so powerful? Well, music in general is easy to remember. If you can't speak a powerful message or a thought, then just sing it. The lyrics allow us to connect with the author because they often describe what we're feeling better than we ourselves can. Just like the Disney Renaissance is popular for all their musical numbers and their songs, the Spider-Verse has increased in popularity because of the music and the lyrics of each of the songs. Each song has a meaning, and we can name a few of them. Familia, basically a family from two different cultures, African-American and Puerto Rican. Scared of the dark, the death of a hero or the death of a role model. Hide, Miles wants to hide from his circumstances and his challenges. And most notably, one of my favorite scenes of all cinematic history, What's Up Danger? This actually might be one of my favorite scenes of a Spider-Man film, at least a Spider-Man movie. So not only is this when Miles transforms from Spider-Boy to Spider-Man, but this scene combines the score, which is the background instrumental music, which I love, but it also combines hip hop and rap together. It has a very brass theme, which is in harmony with a lot of the Spider-Man stuff, but the composer literally takes the classical music and turns into a DJ by remixing it.
Thinking that about Spider-Verse and the way you took an orchestra and scratched it.
I got really into turntablism, which was just people using a record
turntables for scratching, but doing like really inventive stuff with it.
So the music helps describe Miles and it helps move his story along, but there's also something else that helps move Miles along.
My name is Peter B. Parker.
The psychology of mentoring. Here's our second lesson. This movie shows that mentoring doesn't just have to be one-sided. It's not just I teach you and you do this and you learn from me. Mentoring can be two-sided, meaning both sides can learn from each other. And we see this wonderfully with Peter B. Parker and Miles Morales. At first, we think that Peter is going to have the perfect case scenario.
Be fine. I can help you. If you stick around, I can show you the ropes.
Everything works out until... This is when we're introduced to the OG Peter Parker we know and love. I got to geek out for a moment. If I was a fitness influencer and like if I was making serious bank with YouTube, this would probably be me in 20 years. Good and bad. Like I would totally have the dad bod. I would totally have several businesses. I would totally have the complications of being a YouTube fitness influencer. Like this is a very real thing that happens to people. So this could happen even to a superhero and it makes it way more relatable and way more funny.
But I handled it like a champion.
Miles has to learn what it is to be a superhero, but Peter B. Parker also has to learn what it is or relearn what it is to be Spider-Man. By definition, a mentor is an individual with expertise who can help develop the character of a mentee. A mentor often has two primary functions for the mentee. There is the career-related function, which establishes the mentor as a coach, but there's also the psychosocial function, establishing the mentor as a role model and a support system, and that's very real. Peter does do the professional side. He does teach Miles the importance of swinging in combat, but we also see the truthfulness of Peter being a support system for Miles.
He's the Prowler.
Hey, slow down.
He works for Kingpin. He tried to kill me.
This is a pretty hardcore origin story.
I think this relationship works so well because both of these characters demonstrate the quality of respect. Respect means to demonstrate high regard for or special attention to something or someone. At first, Peter and Miles struggle to show respect.
Why are you older? And why is your body a different shape?
Pretty sure you just called me fat.
No.
Once they show respect for each other and once they start bonding over the swinging scene, their relationship continues to get stronger and build from there.
Me as the teacher who could still do it. You as the student who can do it just not as good.
We see how Kingpin and his team falls apart because of lack of respect. There's no communication, there's barely any cooperation, and when cooperation isn't followed, the result is... Well, that's the result. Miles learns a lot about being Spider-Man. Not only does the music tell us about Miles, not only does the mentoring tell us about Miles, but there's one more thing that Miles learns that is bad, but ultimately turns out to be good in the end. And that is our last lesson, which is mistakes.
Just keep going. Just keep going.
Mistakes are a part of the plan.
Make mistakes part of it.
As a post-perfectionist, I used to think that if you made a mistake, your life is over. One thing that can't be said enough is the value of mistakes. At first, Miles and his father, they're on uneven terms until Miles' mistake. Him freezing and not being able to confront his uncle until it's too late is a mistake on his part. But if it wasn't for that mistake, it never would have led to the death of his uncle. It never would have led him to relate to everyone else who's a spider person. And it wouldn't have forced his dad to reach out to him and open the door for a closer relationship. Miles and his dad's relationship is really unique. It's complicated. Trying to express your feelings in a respectful way, especially when you're a teenager, is difficult. And trying to get your parents to not just hear you, but understand where you're coming from, it's a delicate dance, and I think this movie shows it very well. Like, for many teenagers, it's really hard to open up to your parents unless you experience something traumatic like a death in the family. But if it wasn't for that mistake, he never would have had the opportunity to draw closer to his dad, and he never would have earned the rite of passage of becoming a Spider-Man, because most notably about spider people, they always lose somebody who they care about, and to some extent, the blame is on them. There is no Spider-Man without mistakes, and I can't stress that enough. It's difficult to connect to somebody who does everything perfectly and who's a superhero.
Superman, Batman, Green Lantern, and all those people were all perfect.
Well, they were perfect in the sense of the characters they were portraying, but we tried to bring comics a little more into the real world.
That's why we love Spider-Man so much, because this is a person who appears super, but at the end of the day, he's still a human. Sometimes I feel like I'm forced to be like the role model, but I'm no one's role model because I make tons of mistakes. And I always liked Spider-Man, not because he was a role model, but because he's so relatable as somebody who makes mistakes. So I really appreciate that. And as Stan Lee said,
just because a person has a superpower doesn't mean he might not have the same personal problems that you or I might have. Maybe he doesn't have enough money. Maybe he has a family problem. Maybe the girl he loves doesn't love him. There are so many things you can think of that round out the character and the personality. So the superhero isn't just one or two-dimensional. You want a three-dimensional superhero who lives and breathes and worries and experiences things just the way you and I do, except for the fact that he or she has a superpower.
So I can talk about this movie all day, as you can tell. But thank you all so much for watching. If you enjoyed the video, you can give it a like. If you want to talk more down below, feel free to let me know. If you really enjoyed the video, you can share it. And if you're feeling froggy and you want to support the fitness and fandom fams, you can do all three. As always, remember to stay mentally fit, emotionally fit, and physically fit. And I will see you all in the next video.